This video will be making a super acid called chlorosulfonic acid in two different ways. In this exact order, the first one will be the classic laboratory method and the second one will be the roundabout industrial one. So to start, I need some red phosphorus, which is mostly known as a precursor to making meth and the ingredient in shitty explosive compositions. However, this video, we won't be using it for any suspect purpose, as we'll be making some phosphorus pentachloride with it.
Alright, so in very basic terms, here's going to be some chlorine pool tablets, here's going to be some hydrochloric acid, this is going to drip in and generate some chlorine gas. The chlorine gas will get through this pipe here, and this is where it will meet with our red phosphorus.
Here you can see me weighing out some red phosphorus, and damn, it actually looks really nice when it's pure. The red phosphorus was put into a glass tube and I've turned on the chlorine gas generator. Immediately, once the red phosphorus touches the stream of chlorine, a reaction happens where red phosphorus combusts in the chlorine atmosphere to form phosphorus pentachloride, which is the mist that is collecting in the flask. Technically, this reaction is called the fusion of the elements, but I'm not gonna call it that because I personally think that it kinda sounds whack. Eventually, the white mist turns this yellowish color, and that's due to some phosphorus trichloride forming. And to convert the useless trichloride into the useful pentachloride, I generate some excess chlorine, which will react with the trichloride. Eventually, I've tried unplugging the outlet to see if there's any pentachloride there, and as it turns out, it's pretty much clogged, which could generate some pressure, which could be bad. Anyway, I've stopped the experiment and we're left with 10 grams of phosphorus pentachloride, which was moved into my favorite tomato puree jar. Anyway, I've transferred everything into a boiling flask and I've added around 5 grams of concentrated sulfuric acid into it. You can immediately notice a bunch of gas generation, and that's due to the reaction that is happening. Here, we're chlorinating the sulfuric acid molecule to form chlorosulfonic acid, hydrochloric acid and phosphoryl chloride. Because HCl is a gas, it escapes into the atmosphere, and now we're left with a mixture of phosphoryl chloride and chlorosulfonic acid. And you can separate the two using distillation. So I've quickly attached a distillation apparatus to the boiling flask, which I've prepared beforehand. Then I've cranked the heating of my heating mantle to the max. This part is pretty boring, so I'll spare you the details. Eventually, the thermometer in the flask reached 120°C, which means we've successfully separated the phosphoryl chloride from the mixture. Anyway, I've disassembled the apparatus and I've transferred the blackish super acid into a bottle. And totally no strange spillage happened here. Anyway, this was the first way of making the super acid, and it's the most common one in small-scale operations. But what if you don't have red phosphorus and don't want to scrape 100 matchboxes or give your data to the government? What if you're afraid of a painful death from inhaling chlorine gas? Or what if you're just built different like I am? Then, my friend, I present you the industrial route, which involves making oleum, which is just sulfuric acid on steroids. So to start, I've added around 10 grams of phosphorus pentoxide into a flask. Phosphorus pentoxide is much more accessible than red phosphorus or even phosphorus pentachloride, and you can find it on websites like Alibaba for reasonable prices, instead of going through those f***ing shills from Ligma Boldridge. Then, after assembling the apparatus, I've added some sulfuric acid into the flask. It was like 15 grams, but I've performed this experiment so long ago that I don't remember. Anyway, in this reaction, phosphorus pentoxide dehydrates the sulfuric acid molecule to form the sulfuric acid anhydride, also known as sulfur trioxide. For some stupid reason, you have to heat up the solution or sulfur trioxide won't form. And since sulfur trioxide boils slightly higher than room temperature, then it almost immediately vaporizes and makes its way into the condenser. Now here I've done a little trick, which is before starting this procedure, I filled the condenser bulbs with some sulfuric acid. And this immediately dissolves the sulfur trioxide to form the desired oleum. I haven't really seen anybody do this on the internet, which is weird because it's an extremely effective way of making oleum without endangering your life. So I guess after all the talk that I've did like 2 minutes ago, I truly am a pussy in the end. Like for example, look at this guy, he's got no film hood, he's got no gas mask, presumably no clothes, and he still makes sulfur trioxide. I wish to have even 1% of the balls that this guy has. Anyway, I've disconnected the condenser, tilted it so that the oleum could flow all the way into the collection flask, and I've collected all the fuming sulfuric acid. Anyway, next day I've transferred the oleum into a boiling flask and I've set up this really cringy apparatus. Once I was ready, I've added some sulfuric acid into the flask, filled with table salt, and I've stoppered the neck off. This is pretty much the same setup as the first way, but instead of chlorine, we're generating dry hydrochloric acid. And let's zoom into the flask, which had the pipette inserted into it. which acts as the output of our HCl gas generator. And you can almost immediately see a dense white fog over the oleum. In this reaction, we are basically combining the SO3, which is dissolved in the sulfuric acid, with HCl to form chlorosulfonic acid. Anyway, I've distilled the whole thing to separate the superacid from the sulfuric acid, which is surprisingly easy actually, because of the difference of the boiling points. Anyway, I've bottled it and I totally didn't spill it again. You know, if I had a nickel every time I spilled the superacid, I would have two. I mean, it's not that much in terms of money, it's just weird it happened twice. Anyway, the cool part about chlorosulfonic acid is how much it fumes, and how dense the white fumes are. Here you can see me shooting some fumes from a pipette, and I must tell you, it's really cool to play around with. And as you may have noticed, the chlorosulfonic acid doesn't take too kindly to water, as immediately it takes the opportunity to hydrolyze and break down into HCl and sulfuric acid, thus my earlier spillage. In fact, this property is so intense that it reacts with even the slightest bit of moisture in the air to form hydrochloric and sulfuric acids, which is why the mist is so thick here. Anyway, in terms of chemistry, I'll be using it to make saccharin in a future video, which is an artificial sweetener. And I've already used it to make an antibiotic, which you can see on my channel if you subscribe. Oh yeah, also join my Discord too or whatever. Thanks for watching.
Hey you, yeah you, Prussian Blue is coming to Discord. You should join my Discord server now!